now historic event.
I didn't want to do the album if we couldn't get it the way that it was originally, you know, envisioned. So if, you know, I had, you know, the 30 bands that I wanted on there, if three or four of them said, no, we're not interested, then I'm not sure that I would have done it, because I didn't see the point of doing it if it wasn't, you know, as all-encompassing as possible. So I called up Steve Harris, basically, to begin with. I said, look, I'm doing this project. Would you be interested in giving me an Iron Maiden track? And he said yes. And I asked Def Leppard's manager, who I know, and they said yes, and so on. So without necessarily making Iron Maiden and Def Leppard the selling points, because I was very adamant with that with Phonogram, and said, you know, it's not the new wave of British heavy metal featuring Iron Maiden and Def Leppard and 22 other bands. I just knew that if, from my own point of view, if I didn't have a few of those bands committed, then I wasn't going to do it, because I didn't want to do it half-assed, basically. So, you know, but Steve Harris, as you know, is basically the coolest guy in the universe. And he obviously said yes right away. And so did Def Leppard, and so did Samson, and a few of the other big bands. You know, you want to make a record that's historically correct, but you also want to do something that, you know, holds up 10 years later. And so there was a few bands that, a few of the songs were a little sleepy, so it was kind of difficult. But the hardest thing was some of the bands, about maybe five or eight of the bands were all, had, you know, maybe four, five, six great songs, but it was very difficult to sort of just pinpoint it down to one song. For instance, like Tigers of Pantang, or Holocaust, or Samson, or some of these bands that had not necessarily just one, the mega ultra, you know, Samson track, but had a few to choose from, so it took a while to get the track list and finalized it.
We wrote Vice Versa around about the end of 79, and it was when Bruce Dickinson first joined the band. And we eventually got to record it at Ian Gillan's studio in London, which became part of our second album, Head On. And when you listen to the recording, you can see that we were very naive and young. We produced it ourselves, which is a rather silly thing to do because we didn't know anything about studios. But over the years, it sold pretty well, and now it's all coming out again on CD, and it's involved with the New Wave Heavy Metal 10 Years compilation. And we're quite pleased about that.
There are a few...
Come this way. Follow me.
Yeah, follow MXS into North London's Jam Studios, where we meet up with a motley collection of musicians, the All Stars, featuring ex-members of Iron Maiden, Praying Mantis, Girls' School, Lionheart and Samson, plus new boys First Strike. We attempt to capture the tense, hard-working atmosphere of the studio.
Came about because Chris and I produced an album in Japan called Kaizoku. I think that's the right pronunciation.
Kaizoku was basically a lot of a few Japanese musicians and a lot of English musicians getting together and doing a film soundtrack.
And
und zwar mein Freund in England drüben, der Musiker, dem wir erzählt haben, wir machen kleine Party hier, und er sagt, gib mir eine Band und ich spiele mit. Er ist eine Viertelstunde bei den Zöllnern gesessen vorhin, er ist eingetroffen. Hier ist es London, England, zusammen mit Partner Paul Samson.